Hey, welcome to EPN. My name is Victor Lucas, and we bring you the latest in everything cool every single day, thanks in a large part to our pals at the VFS School of Game Design. Thank you so much, Vancouver Film School. Now, this rundown is dedicated to Xavier Pena, who recognized that I was in San Diego yesterday. Thank you for watching. Xavier, this rundown is all yours. Today, I'm in sunny Anaheim. Let's get started. The Sonic the Hedgehog movie has hit a stumble, but it's racing back into development. The big screen adventure based on the beloved video game character has been dropped by distributor Sony Pictures, only to be picked up by rival studio Paramount. Sonic owner Sega had originally announced that they were partnering with Sony to make the film last year, and now that they're working with Paramount instead, it could have major repercussions for the finished film. For starters, Paramount movies tend to receive better critical reception than those produced by Sony Pictures, although Sony as a whole obviously has bigger roots in the video game industry from which Sonic originates. Paramount is bringing in a new producer on the film, Neil H. Moritz, best known for producing the Fast and Furious movies. Most of the original creative team on the Sonic movie remains unchanged, however. It's still being produced by Deadpool director Tim Miller and will mark the directorial debut of visual effects animator Jeff Fowler. It's unclear why Sony dropped the film, although it might have something to do with the box office failure of last year's Ratchet & Clank movie based on Sony's own video game franchise. We'll have to wait and see if the Sonic movie does any better. We do know that it will be a CGI animation and live-action hybrid with a cartoon Sonic interacting with flesh and blood actors. Hopefully he doesn't have another romance with a human woman.
Definitely.
The Sonic movie is slated to put a ring on theaters next year. And Sonic the Hedgehog isn't the only video game icon leaving Sony. Sony Interactive Entertainment president and global CEO Andrew House, who has essentially been in charge of all things PlayStation, is stepping down. He held the job since 2013 and oversaw the launch of the PS4, which helped put Sony back on top of the console market. House will remain as a chairman for the time being, but will no longer be in charge of what happens with the PlayStation line. In his place, another Sony executive, John Codera, has already been promoted to take his job. John Codera has been at Sony since 1992 and has led their network services since 2013. He oversaw the development and launch of the PlayStation Network in 2006, as well as the more recent game streaming service, PlayStation Now. So what does this mean for the future of PlayStation? Given Codera's background as an online network guy, it indicates that Sony consoles might have further integration with online services like PlayStation Now. Andrew House was also very dismissive of handheld gaming like the PlayStation Vita, so now that he's gone, it could mean that Sony will be more willing to consider handheld gaming once again at some point in the future. We'll just have to wait and see. It might be getting easier making games for the Nintendo Switch. Unity Technologies, which makes the popular Unity engine, has announced that they're working with Nintendo to improve how their software works on the platform. Many third-party developers have publicly stated that they've had problems working with Unity on the Switch, most notably Yooka-Laylee developer Playtonic, which recently delayed the Switch version of their game due to technical hurdles. Speaking with GameIndustry.biz, Unity Japan regional director Hiroki Omei says that they're currently working with Nintendo to further optimize the engine for the Switch, although he didn't reveal a timeline for when the issues might be solved. Hopefully it's sooner rather than later. The Unity engine is used primarily by indie developers, so any problems with it could make developers less likely to create games for the Switch. Nintendo itself has been working hard to get more indie games on the system, particularly with their Nindies initiative, so they're probably working very hard to find a fix. You might not need a Super Nintendo Classic in order to play the system's big exclusive game. Bootleg copies of Star Fox 2 have begun appearing online. What makes these bootlegs unique is that hackers claim to have found a way to take the Star Fox 2 ROM file off of the new SNES Classic and put it on old SNES cartridges, which, if the hackers are to be believed, makes the game playable on an original Super Nintendo system for the very first time. We don't vouch for the reliability of these bootlegs, and they're obviously illegal, but the idea of Star Fox 2 running on an original Super Nintendo will no doubt be of interest to hardcore Nintendo enthusiasts. Star Fox 2 was originally developed for the Super Nintendo back in 1995 and was almost finished when Nintendo abruptly pulled the plug and canceled it to instead focus on Star Fox 64. They included Star Fox 2 on the Super Nintendo Classic as a special bonus, making it the game's first official release ever. Hopefully Nintendo will release it digitally on the eShop for all of those who haven't been able to get their hands on the SNES Classic. The system is sold out pretty much everywhere, but new supplies are on the way. Over in the galaxy far, far away, you don't have to wait any longer to play Star Wars Battlefront 2. No, not the new game. That doesn't come out until next month. The original Star Wars Battlefront 2, released for the PC in 2005, is once again playable on both Steam and rival gaming service GOG. The multiplayer has been unavailable through official channels since the GameSpy multiplayer service shut down in 2014, but Disney, which didn't actually own the franchise when the game was first released, has brought new servers online, much to the delight of fans everywhere. Battlefront 2 has already spiked in popularity as a result, with some gamers even unable to log on due to overcrowding. That's pretty surprising for a game that's 12 years old. I guess the Empire really did strike back. The multiplayer resurgence has only happened on the PC, though, so don't bother breaking out the PS2 or Xbox versions of the game. Disney is doing this to coincide with the open beta for the new Star Wars Battlefront 2, which kicks off tomorrow on the PC and consoles. The full version of the new Battlefront 2 deploys November 17th.
Let's give him everything we got!
That's it for the rundown. Thank you so much for watching. If you'd like to learn more about game design, visit our pals at VFS.edu. We'll be back again tomorrow with a brand new episode for you. But in the meantime, don't forget to watch some of the other material that we've been making. And if you dig it, hit subscribe, okay?